This video is brought to you by Soundstripe. Get 3 royalty-free music tracks by clicking the link in the video description. So today we're going to talk about 3 ways to get your edit to feel right. I'm excited about this episode because I think today we might go a little closer to that enigma that is editing. How can you tell good editing? Am I right?
Absolutely right. You don't go to a movie to see continuity. What's the editor doing besides keeping continuity? How are they making the actual edits have some kind of emotional response from an audience? Rhythm in film editing is time, energy, and movement shaped by timing, pacing, and trajectory phrasing for the purpose of creating cycles of tension and release. Some wonderful scholars and colleagues of mine in the Netherlands wrote an article called Seeing Yourself in the Past, in which they say viewers are able to infer the meanings from the cinematic form because they embody the knowledge that filmmakers use to impose those meanings artistically. So what they're saying is the meaning making is grounded in your bodily knowledge, like what you know as a living being functioning in this world.
So it's almost like when you see a movie and you can't quite hear the dialogue, but you still follow what's going on.
Right. When we see performances on screen, we can connect to what their movement means because we know what that movement feels like in our own bodies. But what an editor is doing is actually directing our eye to the movement that's holding the really important meaning. This is one thing that continuity editing is designed to do. For his article, Attentional Theory of Cinematic Continuity, Tim J. Smith did eye tracking experiments, and then he made heat maps to show where eyes are moving as they watch film. From these experiments, Tim found that what feels right in continuity editing is a smooth attentional shift across cuts. But I'm suggesting that while smooth cuts are fine and good to make, editors might sacrifice perfect smoothness to do something more. Tim Smith's looking at this scene and he says, there's something weird going on here. There's one cut that doesn't work in the way that I'm theorizing that it works. For whatever reason, that owl looks over Deckard's head and it cues your eyes to slip over Deckard's head and then you slip him back.
I see.
And we're talking milliseconds, right? Not at a conscious level. If you look at the other shots in the scene, your eyes go directly to the other character's eyes. A cut can do more than preserve continuity, and if it can, it will. If artistry of another order is available. This kind of slight mismatch in the gazes of the two characters, the owl and Deckard, it's not accidental.
Maybe this is intentional because something happened that disrupts the stability of the scene.
Exactly. I reckon this cut disrupts this rule of smooth attention, but it feels right for 3 reasons. It creates a movement phrase. It's like a statement of a rhythmical idea. So you say, the owl moves right, left, Deckard moves right, left. It engages us in its rhythm at a bodily level. It adds a rhythmic quality to the narrative, to the storytelling. I would also say it does something else that's really important. It creates kinesthetic empathy. It creates empathy in the viewer's body with Deckard's own kind of uneasiness in the space. The last thing it does is it creates subtext. When you make that rhythmic phrase, 1-2, 1-2, essentially this cut is saying Deckard and the owl are alike.
Mm-hmm.
The next line, Rachel says, Do you like our owl? Deckard asks, is the owl artificial?
Of course it is.
Deckard might also be artificial because they move alike in this way. So the cut creates a thought. It creates a movement phrase that makes us think and feel just through the rhythm of the movement.
The reward is on the audience because they kind of have a hunch at that point. They suspect something.
What kind of movie is this?
And that hunch, it's the right feeling for that moment. And it was created by the editors.
It seems you feel our work is not a benefit to the public.
Here's another theory. Why something feels right to an editor. What feels right is the movement that triggers embodied simulation response. Vittorio Gallese, the Italian neuroscientist, has articulated as being this way that our bodies will respond to movement by mirroring it. And that's how we know what it means. That's how we can empathize with movement. And that's how we know how things feel to other people.
I think I'll never have a shower again.
I was at South by Southwest, saw the film that I cut, and I sat deliberately with the audience. The great thing is I can pick up the energy of the room that way. It's not so much really observing them, it's like just picking it up. What I imagine it is with birds flying in synchrony, they just feel where they are and they make these slight adjustments. After seeing it three times with three different audiences, I could really pinpoint specific moments in the film where I'm like, we're taking too much time to explain something. Let's cut that. I had this opportunity to just open up the movie again and just make those slight adjustments for what I think is going to be a better experience.
Fantastic example of putting theory into practice. You watch your film with other people in the room and you use your sense of embodied simulation to improve your cuts.
It's getting there.
What Gallese is trying to get at is before sharing the experiences of the characters, the viewer shares the experiences of the camera. Gallese makes an example of this fantastic scene from the film Notorious, a Hitchcock film. We think she's moving towards the keys, and then it turns out it's actually just the camera moving towards the keys, and she's still stuck back in the doorframe wondering whether to move or not. Just before that important camera move, the last few frames of that shot of Alicia are slightly out of focus. And you can tell by the fact that it's out of focus that neither Hitchcock nor the camera operator really expected her to do that. And what the editor, whose name is Theron Worth, has done is he's prioritized movement phrasing over perfect focus. He's making us feel with Alicia, and that camera movement is more important than keeping the shot.
The other thing that I notice is that she moves forward and stops, and then the camera that is in a stop position starts moving.
Yep.
So it's really not one continuous movement, it's really two waves.
It's a movement phrase. It has a rhythm, and you can kind of imagine it as a breath rhythm or something. It's like if she's going, and then the camera's going, you know, and there's that little stutter between them that is how our body feels in response to her, like, terribly anxious state. That's a trajectory phrase that makes us feel with the character. The editor is an expressive artist in shaping this movement, and they're using their own body to make something feel right.
That's the cool thing about this, is these are the thousand little decisions that you do as an editor on your own time when you start telling that story.
This brings me to my third example, which this amazing editor, Sven Pape, who has what I'm calling kinesthetic imagination.
Let's do it. What is that?
Kinesthetic imagination is this capacity to kind of imagine movement feeling. It's strengthened like a muscle through lots of practice and through respecting that question, does it feel right, and getting in there and making it feel right. Your episode, which is The Upside of Procrastination, this crazy good editor, Sven Pape, shows us like 17 possible shots he could use to make the sequence. If he used all those 17 shots, he could make something that has perfect continuity.
It's basically Mark waking up and he's sneaking out. So his brother is still sleeping. He's also checking on his mom. Then he writes a note, takes a pushpin, comes down the stairs, puts the note on the wall. The note says, I love you, keep going. And then he disappears.
Then you go away and you're letting them play around in your imagination as possible combinations. And you're kind of imagining movement flows. And when you come back to it the next day, you just have three shots. It's poetry.
So we've seen these three examples. What's the take-home from this?
An editor may use time, space, and movement in any number of creative ways to generate physically, emotionally, and narratively expressive sequences.
So I want to ask you, the audience, what you think is the most important part of editing that makes it feel right.
Now, there's a really cool deep dive on the eye tracking experiments by Tim J. Smith, and I'm going to show you a sneak peek in a second.
But there's something else going on here as well. It's not motion in isolation.
But first, I want to take a brief moment to thank Soundstripe for their support. You can get three free music tracks from a variety of playlists, plus a 15% discount on a future purchase by using the code ThisGuyEdits. Soundstripe provides royalty-free tracks with simple licensing so that you can use their music in your projects however you want. Based in Nashville, the three company owners are professional musicians themselves with a love for authentic music. They only hire pro musicians and recording artists. So, grab your three free tracks by clicking the link in the description. Now, Tim J. Smith and Dr. Karen Pearlman both gave talks about how cuts work. And by the way, Karen wrote an academic paper that includes some early videos from this channel. If you want to get a free download of this publication, consider becoming a patron and you'll get free access. That's a $20 value, plus all the other goodies Patreon members get to enjoy. Now, here's a glimpse of Tim's presentation, plus links to both of their talks. Happy editing.
So this is a demonstration from There Will Be Blood that I did a few years ago, where we can look at the gaze behavior and how it switches with the social interaction of the characters in the sequence. So when Paul looks down and touches the map, your gaze will go down and follow his interest. If the dialogue switches between Daniel and Paul, your gaze goes with it too, switches to Paul, and then switches to Daniel's son, HW, over here. We also cue gaze by one person looking at another character or by suddenly moving their hands. Sudden social changes like that will draw attention to it, and it does it pretty universally across viewers. This can be used in the edit because you can anticipate when and where gaze is going to go. So you can create a shift in attention that you can then use to guide attention to a new shot. ¶¶